The Philippine Stock Exchange Index opens lower at 62.50. Joining us today for his take on the market, Julian Tarabago, SVP and Chief Investment Officer of Union Bank. Julian, good morning and welcome back on the program.
Good morning, Rin. Happy to be here.
Right, so the last chat with you, May 31st, we had global supply shocks as a top concern. Now it's worsened by U.S. inflation, 9.1%, the expected Fed action, and everybody's going to feel it. And back then, in a market that has underperformed, you still saw an 18% growth forecast. Has that had to be revisited today?
Yes, obviously we've had to reassess the conditions and we've had to simulate the most possible scenarios, and in the process we tweaked our base case assumptions, which has led to both lower year-end PSEI targets, and although we are seeing improvements in 2022 and 2023 and 2024, our base case now assumes reopening momentum still continuing, inflation peaking in 3Q, and easing in the fourth quarter with some form of demand destruction or growth implications. And these support still, after our regular channel checks with the companies, with the corporates, still support earnings growth of about 18% this year. We are looking at a strong second quarter earnings print. I can talk about that a bit later if you'd like. But basically, this assumption of 18% earnings growth for this year assumes earnings reaching about 95% of 2019 levels or pre-pandemic or pre-lockdown levels, which is still below, again, the lockdown earnings. And if these happen, we believe the market will be re-rated. Hence, we still have higher, significantly higher index targets for the year, as the market eventually recognizes the earnings growth prospects and attractive valuations in the Philippine equity market. We're looking at about 16.5 times price earnings ratio re-rating. This is still one standard deviation below the historical average of the market. And this translates to a PSEI target of about 7,100 by year end. That's about 13-14% higher from current levels. So we're still optimistic because we think that when inflation pressures eventually wane or ease, and assuming earnings grow by an average of about 12-15% in the next 3 years, we see the PSEI reaching 9,300 by 2023 year end, and to about 10,900 up to 2024. These seem like high targets right now, but the simple assumption here is that earnings grow by about 12-15% in the next 2 years after growing 18% this year. And again, this is significant because it implies that if you can withstand the short-term volatility or the near-term volatility, which we think will persist, and we're seeing that in the markets today, the PSEI can potentially give you, based on these targets. That's why it's important for long-term investors to be able to see where this thing is eventually headed. We're recognizing the risks in the short term, hawkish central bank policy, inflation, the weak currency, and all that. But over the next 3 years, we think PSEI has the capability of giving investors, long-term investors, annualized returns of about 19.4% based on these targets. So we're looking, we're recognizing the clutter. We've positioned the portfolios as such to navigate through this the short-term headwinds, but we're not losing sight of where the market would be when things come closer to some form of normalization. And we think the risk-return proposition is quite attractive. If you can look past this year into 2023 and 2024.
Quite optimistic indeed and quite comprehensive, definitely. But let's take a look at one of those short-term risks. Businesses, of course, closely watching the peso and interest rate adjustments. We're crossing 56 pesos to the dollar on a regular basis. Do you see the peso passing the all-time high of 56.45 to the dollar? And May we get your year-end outlook for the local currency and how you hope the Monetary Board will hike rates?
That's a good question. Our estimate is for the dollar peso to range from within 56 and 57 pesos for the remainder of 2022. The high current account deficit due to higher commodity prices and hyper-aggressive U.S. Fed tightening makes assets relatively attractive due to the higher interest rate differential, which could keep the dollar strong. That said, we don't see the dollar peso spiraling out of control at this point, given the BSP dollar reserves, while narrowing, still offer quite a hefty import cover of about, I think, 9 months of imports. Also, the central bank has said that it will hike rates by a bigger amount if the peso weakens too fast and by too much. So that said, we think the BSP will likely hike above the usual 25 basis points in the next meeting and subsequent meetings and until they come closer to the terminal rate of about 3.5%, probably by year end.
All right. Well, going back to one of your earlier points on the second quarter earnings reports, you had been disappointed by last quarter's earnings reports with all the factors affecting costs. What are your earnings expectations for the stocks you're closely watching now?
Again, we're optimistic because we think Philippine equities present 19% potential annualized returns over the next 3 years. We still like banks, and we also like the blue chips that are trading at deep discounts to intrinsic value, which were sold down, we think unjustifiably, more for market de-risking reasons or index rebalancing reasons rather than more fundamentally rooted reasons. Which companies will drive earnings? We think banks will do well, interest rates going up, loans get repriced higher, possible revenge lending or improvement in lending, and maybe some reversal of provisions that the banks had to be conservative with in terms of providing for potential NPLs. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you are optimistic and moving forward. Do you see any winners or even losers in these third and fourth quarters? Are there sectors you'll be counting on to support the market in the latter half of the year?
I think especially after the second quarter numbers come out, the emphasis will continue to be on the reopening plays. And as I mentioned, banks benefit, malls benefit, consumer discretionary benefits. So I would think more along those lines, and perhaps some profit-taking or underperformance in terms of the sectors that have outperformed massively, which are not so much or not directly related or linked to the reopening theme. In the second quarter, we mentioned we think it's going to be strong because our view is that the pent-up demand reopening theme will benefit the earnings of the companies and will more than offset the cost pressures the companies are starting to feel at this point. We're looking at probably around 28% growth in the second quarter earnings number.
All right. Meanwhile, we have a new IPO in the offing in renewable energy. Can you share with us what might be your prospects for Alternergy and the energy sector?
Well, we think it's in a good sector to be in, particularly given what we expect to be very tight supply-demand situation in the next at least the next 2 years for the Philippines, and we need all the help we can get in terms of power generators, so especially in the clean or renewable energy space. So it's in a good sector. I haven't dive deep into this particular IPO, but what I can say is it's in a very lucrative sector to be in, and relevant sector to be in at this point.
All right. And in recent days, analysts have said while waiting on the sidelines, they're just invested in bonds and REITs and maybe some dividend plays. Would you recommend the same?
We think that makes total sense, but we would be more selective in terms of going into fixed income. We are actually still underweight on Philippine fixed income, but we are cognizant of value in the steepest parts of the yield curve. For example, the GS rallied, I think, 20 to 30 basis points on strong demand in the recent 7-year auction, while we're still underweight, as we say. We're overweight in some of the steepest parts of the yield curve, especially with the 7 to 10 year tenors currently offering 6.6 to 6.9% and trading close to 2018 levels. So yeah, it makes sense to be selective in that space, I would think. But as a general strategy or tactical positioning, we're still underweight on Philippine fixed income.
And finally, the State of the Nation address of a new president in a few days. What do you think investors would like to hear in terms of policy and legislation?
Well, we think more of, we anticipate them to talk more about the priorities in terms of key areas, key priorities in the economy, for example, which the economic team has laid out quite articulately so far. Keeping inflation in check, infrastructure-driven investments, how the back-to-school protocols or system will be, and so on and so forth.
All right. Julian Tarubago, SVP and Chief Investment Officer of the Union Bank. Thank you again for sharing your market guidance with us. We appreciate it, as always.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you.